Motion number three is in the name of Deputy Catherine Connolly. Deputy, you have 4 minutes.
Minister, I raised this matter last week in relation to the forest fires which raged all of the week in Connemara. And in the first instance, I'd like to pay tribute to the staff on the ground, the Air Corps, the Army, the Gardaí, the National Parks and Wildlife, the staff of Cuilte, and indeed Muintir na Háite, Iad Héin. However, when I raised it last week, and there was a five-page response from one of your colleagues, the only reference to Galway in that was that we're aware that the fires are burning. Now, the extent of the fire is absolutely extraordinary, and I understand that you were down there yourself this week and witnessed the aftermath where the green has been turned to brown and black. Now, the Cluais Valley has a forest that's the biggest in Ireland, as you're aware, 4,000 hectares. Almost a quarter of that has been destroyed, in addition, 2,000 hectares of bogland. When the fire raged, it raged on three fronts, and one of them extended across 8 kilometres. Now, wildlife, the forest itself, the bogland, and a huge threat to family life. And I have to say, in the context of that, and it wasn't yourself, but it certainly indicated that the government was not aware, or certainly was not taking seriously, what was going on in Galway over that extensive area of land with that destruction of forest. First of all, the threat to human life. Secondly, the absolute damage to wildlife, to the trees, the cost of that, the cost of losing mature timber, what it's going to cost to replace it, the pollution from the Citizen Science Project on the radio said that we were on par with Beijing. And the only difference was that it obviously wasn't going to last, whereas Beijing, unfortunately, has an ongoing problem. But it was equal to the pollution in Beijing where they wear masks. My question, really, besides the fact that nobody went down in time, and I thank you, Minister, for going down this week, but I would have expected somebody to go down sooner. I see that you've issued a warning to the area, which indeed is welcome, because nobody should be lighting fires, and particularly illegal fires. However, there's a bigger problem than that, and questions have to be asked in relation to how this got out of control. What risk assessments have been done by Cuilte? Within the biggest forest in the country, we have the biggest wind farm. Feelings on the ground was that some of the effort went in more to preserving. There were feelings, I'm simply reporting what was said, rather than into a control in the fire elsewhere. But in the last 10 years, there have been very few prosecutions. I think if my figures are right, there were 9 prosecutions over a 10-year period. Now, I would ask you, I know you're going to deal with the prosecutions, but I'm asking a more general question. I'm asking when you, as Minister, is going to get a report back, A, on what caused the fire, B, what has been learned from that, because no matter what we do, we're going to always have people who light fires that shouldn't. There must be an emergency plan in place, a proper risk assessment. So when will that report come back before us, telling us the damage, telling us what are the replacement plans, telling us the time span, most of all, how we can prevent this happening in the future. That is the most important lesson that has to be learned from this.
Thank you very much, Deputy Minister. 4 minutes.
Thank you, Cathaoirleach, and I'd like to thank Deputy Connolly for raising this very serious issue. As you know, and as you've said in your own opening statement, I visited Cluais Valley in Galway on Monday and saw for myself at first hand the utter devastation caused by the wildfire which had raged there until Thursday last, the 11th of May, when it was finally brought under control. As I commented during my visit, fire poses a serious risk to life, homes and property. Forestry and wildlife habitats are also destroyed. I understand that while a wildfire risk can quickly develop following a dry weather pattern or dry weather patterns in all areas where flammable vegetation such as grasses, gorse and heather are present, especially in proximity to forests and other assets, most fires have been started deliberately. To set a fire at this time of the year is not only illegal, it's totally irresponsible. As we are all aware, the burning of vegetation is controlled by the Wildlife Act. It is an offence under Section 40 of the Wildlife Act 1976 to burn from the 1st of March to the 31st of August. in any year any vegetation growing on the land not then cultivated. Individuals who are found to burn vegetation within that prohibited period are liable to prosecution by An Garda Síochána Síochána or by the National Parks and Wildlife Service. The Department of Agriculture actually has no role in this regard. Forest fires have a wide range of impacts. In relation to the Clush Valley, I think it was about 1,500 hectares of forestry was destroyed, and a similar, maybe a little bit more, of bogland on the perimeter, which is actually where the forest spread from. This is a huge loss. I mean, the estimates are about 4 million. To put it in context, the level of new planting annually for which the grants have been paid for over the last couple of years is in the region of 6,500 hectares. So to lose 1,500 hectares in one fell swoop like this gives an indication of how massive this incident actually was. In relation to the loss, there's loss of value to the timber crop itself, the reconstitution costs, and to the cost of reconstitution. There is also an immediate cost involved in the forest suppression costs incurred by Quilcha and other agencies and bodies, such as Galway Forest Service and the Air Corps, which were involved in monitoring and fighting the fires. In time of budgetary control, such outbreaks put a heavy strain on all of these bodies. Quilcha, for example, have estimated the cost to be in the millions in total to them. Other costs which are difficult to quantify include the disruption to normal fire service operation and the diversion of emergency service resources away from other life-saving operations. I focused on the impact of my area of immediate responsibility, which is forestry, but I should advise that another impact of the risk is the risk to payments under the basic payment scheme, which I outlined as I advised in my statement yesterday. Officials in my department are currently analysing a wide range of satellite imagery to identify land which was burnt illegally during the specified closed season for burning. Historic satellite imagery is also being examined as part of this process. Agricultural and eligible forestry land identified as burnt illegally as part of this investigation will be deemed to be ineligible for payments under the 2017 basic payment and other area-based schemes. I'd like to stress in this regard that my department will not tolerate an incidence of illegal burning of land and will take all necessary actions to ensure compliance with the conditions of the various EU-funded area-based schemes, including payments and penalties where applicable.
Thank you, Minister.
Just if I might say, it's another issue that was dealt with. On the matter of the health threat. The Health Service Executive issued a public statement last week about the recent gorse fires, and I think they advised that people should limit the amount of time they spent outdoors in the areas affected by the smoke and ash, and I understand that smoke inhalation can have an adverse effect, especially on vulnerable groups.
Thank you, Minister. Deputy, you have 2 minutes.
Sir, and I welcome what you're setting out, but the difficulty is that gorse fires have raged across all of the West. Serious damage has been done. This isn't the first year that it has happened. It's going on for years. So while I welcome that you're doing, taking satellite images and you're looking at the damage and you're going to take prosecutions if you can, it simply hasn't worked to date. It simply hasn't worked. And a red alert was given by the Department of Agriculture before the fires broke out. And so my question is, when the red alert was given, what did Quilcha do? What emergency plan went into place to prevent, because it was anticipated? I mean, this was perfect. Now, I welcome what Quilcha have done on the ground, but I'm talking on a general level. If a red alert is given in relation to fires, what action was taken by Quilcha? What risk assessment had been carried out, given their experience over the years, given that this is the biggest forest in the country, and given that we know that a small group of people burn illegally, and we actually don't know yet if that was the cause of the fire. We don't know yet. So the risk is too much, the damage is too much. I mean, I haven't gone into the effect on bird life and diversity. And so on. The immediate concern was obviously human life and houses. But this shouldn't have happened. And I really want to know when we will get a report back as to what was lacking in the risk assessment or the health and safety statement and all the other things that are relevant in relation to a forest of this size with the biggest wind farm. Why wasn't it anticipated? And they're my questions in addition to the prosecutions, because they're always going to be just a side issue, really, in relation to the overall plan. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Deputy Minister. You have 2 minutes.
Yeah, look, I appreciate the points that's been raised. I visited the site. I can tell you the work that was done there, there was over 100 people between Quilcha staff, the Army, Air Corps, some private helicopters who were experts in what they did, and that was really, at some stages, this could be provocative, but I was at a point where there was a new infrastructure road there built by the wind company, 50 metres, and because it was a crown fire, it jumped it. So, but those roads, 62 kilometres of new road infrastructure, allowed the emergency services to get in. If you look at, I looked at the map before I went up there, and the point where the suspicion is that the fire would have originated from is some distance to the southeast of the actual plantation, and the fire would have travelled pretty fast through what is bogland and SAC. And I think the problem is, if you were to look at an emergency planning, just a contingency planning again, one would need to look at the perimeter, notwithstanding all the precautions that have to be made on site, but one would need to look at the perimeter and see how that vegetation can be controlled and managed. And look, there is, the MPWS can give derogations to control by use of controlled burning, which is an essential part of actually vegetation management, so that the material can be edible. And there was a noticeable lack of livestock and sheep on that ground, one way or the other. So I think what they need to do is look, and this is, I wouldn't pretend to be the expert, but I think they really need to look at how they control that buffer zone and control the vegetation so it never gets to the point where it's that tall, very dry and very highly calorific material that will burn. I've seen them on the Wicklow Gap in Wicklow, Cahirlock, where it can be hill walkers, it can be people, recklessness, throwing out a cigarette butt in the dry time with the wind in the right direction. As you say, everything hit perfectly, and it was the wind and the change in direction of the wind and the drop in temperature which assisted greatly last Wednesday in reducing the threat. Thank you.
Minister.